Welcome everybody. Hello, greetings from Prague, from the headquarters of the Czech Christian Academy and Emmaus Monastery. And we are happy to see all of you. And we continue in our lectures in context of the Templeton Founded Project. Faith and beliefs of non-believers, and today's lecture is given by Máté-Tóth, but András Máté-Tóth from Hungary, and the title is Religion in Societies of a Wounded Collective Identity. So, András, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. I am really happy, and it is not an empty politeness to say, I am really happy to be with you together in this online platform. And I am as well very happy to have the possibility to explain something about my theory of wounded collective identity. And I will focus in this lecture on the religious dimension of our societies. And my main question is, with them I am dealing now, how can we perhaps better and more appropriate understand the religious transformations in our contemporary time if we take these so-called wounded collective identity. And now I try to share my presentation. The first is something about my personal experiences, why I came to the work for an alternative understanding of our region. You know, mostly Tomáš, Halík know how we started around of the system change to visit different Western European countries and conferences. We were invited, and very soon I have had the feeling, and perhaps I was not alone with, that people in Western Europe are very soon absolutely clear about what happened in our countries, what is the main reason of the so-called system change, and concerning religion, how we should understand these transformations. They have had already some theoretical frameworks. They have a very stable hermeneutic to understand the transformation in Central and Eastern Europe and to understand the religious dimension of this transformation. So, but for me and for all of us at that time who were coming from these countries and we experienced this change, this system change, for us was it a little bit a worst experience. I felt me wrong because I didn't find the appropriate words to explain what we experienced during the system change and after. So that what were stated by different theoretical frameworks and by very, very good scholars, according to the understanding what happened, it correspond fewer and fewer with my own understanding of the region. And I felt me worst dressed like Charlie Chaplin. Therefore, he is there with the picture. So the clothes given by these very engaged and very clever Western European colleagues stand so as the closest for by Charlie Chaplin. So the tension was growing between a heteropoietic epistemology and the lack of an autopoietic viewpoint. As I use these technical terms, heteropoietic and autopoietic, I refer more or less to Niklas Luhmann's theory about the self-referential systems, but not too strong. The heteropoietic and autopoietic are nice words for me as well, because poiesis means in Greek to establish something, but poiesis as well means something as a lyric. It is a verbal creation, and therefore I think we as scholar are in the process of verbal creation of the word, of the understandable word. So I would like to go a little bit more deeper in what means the so-called heteropoietic point of view. First, I would like to mention now Peter Berger. I was very close with him. Sometimes we discussed about this question of vulnerability and wounded collective identity. So he is representatives for the very famous theoretical approach to the question of religion, the so-called theory of secularization. And we know very simple, the theory of secularization has the argument the more modern a society is, the less religious is it. Although Peter Berger was a leading scholar in the 60s by the elaborating of this theory, after them we all know very good, very, very clear how he regret and how he said the theory of secularization was an interesting theory, but it was theoretically wrong, and as well it was wrong in the mirror of the data collected outside of the Western European societies. But the theory of secularization is, although with many critics, is still vivid. So another important scholar, our friend, Jose Casanova. And Jose Casanova, not independent from the problem with the theory of secularization, roughly after 30 years after the original explaining of the theory of secularization, he wrote and published his famous book, Public Religion. And he mentioned the theory of secularization concentrates on one dimension of the society and on one dimension of the presence of religion in the society. But there is another type of presence, and this presence is the public presence of religion. And so he concentrated on the state level, what functions has religion regarding the states, regarding the politics, and as well regarding to the civil society. So although Casanova and then and later on as well, Charles Taylor clarified a lot of questions concerning the theory of secularization. It is something as a permanent dancing around of the tree of the theory of secularization, if we are speaking in a scholarly way about the religious transformations in the entire globe. And it is for me not a question how important this theory is, and it is not a question for me whether we should use this theory or not as well for our Central and Eastern European cultural region. It is not my question. I am not against the theory, but my argument is that beside of this theory, we have experiences which can by this theory of secularization not really good and appropriate interpreted. And that is my point, and therefore I started to shift my viewpoint from the so-called North Atlantic hemisphere to the Central and Eastern European region. Why I am saying North Atlantic hemisphere? Because the genealogy of these theories by Peter Elberger, by Casanova, and I will in the next slide mention some other theories as well, The genealogy show how these theories are arisen from the context of the Western European modernization or North American modernization. And I think it is possible or it is needed to focus on the experiences of another region, a really different region inside of Europe, in Europe, and it is our region, Central and Eastern Europe. So, but why wounds collective identity? Of course, you all know that wounds are in Greek, or the term wound is in Greek trauma. And if I am saying the traumatized collective identity, then it is more or less the same as the wounded collective identity. But I decided to use the word wound, not at least because in the scholarly literature, the vulnerability, the technical term word vulnerability, is very often used. Let me mention three scholars regarding this sensitivity to the vulnerability. The one is Peter Elberger in his famous book written with or co-authored by Thomas Luckmann, The Social Construction of the Reality. They elaborated the theory, the so-called plausibility structures. And they said, or they argued, that all communities, all societies, and all persons as well, needs something which is a plausibility structure. Plausibility structure is something as a sacred canopy, as Peter Berger named it later, or it is the word of the taken for grantedness. So for the orientation, for the reflex kind orientation for people, it is important to have a plausibility structure. So today we would like to say mindset, because this mindset makes possible the basic orientation for the private persons and for groups and for societies as well. And Peter Elberger and Thomas Luckmann mentioned, if we have no, or if these plausibility structures have wounds, or were or became destroyed, or unstable, then it is a catastrophe for the private person, for families, for societies too, because then became the society anomical, and anomy is taken from Emil Durkheim. It is something as a chaos, and chaos is in a society always destructive. So important is Peter Eberger, because the question of the instable plausibility structure is very clear connected with the theory of wounded collective identity. The second important sociologist is Anthony Giddens. And Anthony Giddens argued that people need to have something which he called ontological security. Ontological security, Giddens went back with this theory to some philosophers like Galen or Plessner, and they meant quite the same, that people need ontological security. To own is an existence. To own is the something which is. It is to be. And if the people don't have this security that they are in the entire globe, as well regarding to the transcendence at home, then they are not able to work and to live properly. Now it is interesting that in the last 10-15 years, Giddens' idea concerning ontological security is, although quoted, but changed to the technical term of ontological insecurity. And it is as well an argument for me that the woundedness and vulnerability is present in the scholarly literature, and this enforce me to work with this technical term, wounded collective identity. And the last one is Ronald Englehart. He died some weeks ago, if I am right. He is a famous scholar, the leading scholar of the so-called word value study. And in his book, very important book, published 2004, based on an incredible huge amount of statistical data collected by, I think, more than 40 or perhaps more than 50 countries. Based on these data, he elaborated a very important argument concerning the existential security. And he meant existential security need people, because if they lack this existential security, then they have a totally other type of value system. As people, they have this existential security. Okay, existential was for Ronald Englehart more financial security, but the sensibility to the question existential security, and then later on he published some articles where he mentioned existential insecurity, is more and more growing in the entire world, but mostly outside of Europe, mostly in the countries of the South. So his argument support as well the idea that we can take a basic theory based on the question of vulnerability and wounds. So my argument is then the geopolitical and geocultural insecurity is the main marker of Central and Eastern Europe. To be concrete, Central and Eastern Europe, it is the Baltic states, it is Eastern European states, it is the Central European states, and it is the West and the East Balkan, it is then Central Eastern Europe. So we can as well say it is the western part of the Eastern Bloc, of the Soviet Bloc. So these status, or the status of these countries, are characterized all by all are characterized through something which I call betweenness. They are area between big hegemonies. Big hegemonies from the West, from the East, from the Baltic states, at least in the Middle Age, from the North, and for the Balkan, East Balkan states, because of the Ottoman Empire, from the South. So it is very important to recognize the legacy or the heritage, long durée heritage, of all these countries. Although some populations become more significant principality in the Middle Age, like for example Bulgaria, but the majority of today's states missed between 200 and 400 years long their sovereignty, the lack of sovereignty, the lack of autonomy, the lack of having an autonomous national state. It is long durée the most significant heritage of this region, and it comes from this geographical fact that these all countries or all folks are living in the between situation, in the between and big between situation of these big cultural and financial hegemonies. So in the 20th century, if we focus on this century, then we have five wounds, and these five wounds made stronger the long durée experience, the long durée historical experience of the region, and enforced these experiences generation by generation. And so these five wounds, it is a typology. We can, of course, discuss whether we should have not only five, but six or seven, or not five, but only three. It is no matter. The matter is that this type of wounds in our region are common. All societies have these wounds or these tragedies. And in the contemporary memory, are these wounds vivid and plays a decisive role. So the five wounds are occupation by hegemonies, as I mentioned, the Ottoman, the fascist, the Soviet hegemonies, and losing or never becoming state sovereignty, and then the prohibition of using ethnic language and minority rights, and then the violent deportation and forced social mobilization. The forced social mobilization means that after every system changes, the high society was persecuted, and from the low society, people were enforced and mobilized to go to the important places in the society. And after all system changes, it happened in every societies. And then the persecution of religion, churches and dissidents, it is an evidence in our group. It is an evidence how important the dimension is the persecution of religion and churches, because we all know that for the Soviet regime, started by Lenin and then the more started by Stalin, the most important enemy was for the communist ruler, religion and religious institutions. So although today perhaps in some countries religion plays not a so important role than in other, but this persecution of religion is a core point to understand what was exactly communism and what happened with religion in our countries. Although I am not for an interpretation of the religious transformation by starting of the communist occupation and of the communist persecution of religion, because in the theory of wounded collective identity, as well, religions plays along durée the role, the different role in the societies. And if we try to understand what means religion today, then we should not only go back to the communist takeover, but to go back to two or perhaps 400 years more. So, and the last wound is there are the genocides and other kind of mass killings. By genocides, I mentioned not only the genocides against the Jewish people, but as well the genocides against the Bosniak people in Srebrenica, 50 years after Auschwitz. But if I mention another kind of mass killings, there are a lot of smaller mass killings in the region. For example, Hakin is well known, but very near to Szeged, 50 or 60 kilometers from Szeged to south in the Vojvodina. They are as well mass killings, remembering. So it is characteristic for our region that genocides and mass killings happen or happened. So after clearing the core elements or the core understanding of the wounded collective identity as a original approach taken based on the historical and contemporary experience of the Central Eastern Europe, I would like to look to some today's features of our region, which are very good and very appropriate interpreted or can be interpreted by this wounded collective identity. So I call it the hermeneutical capacity of the theory. So they are the legacies we can observe in these societal features and characteristics, the legacy of the woundedness. The first is the memory politics. The memory politics has the only one aim in all of our societies, the establishment or the re-establishment of the nation state after communism. If you visit the museums in every countries, then it is they are focused to this establishment or re-establishment. It is important for some countries, they have longer history behind. It is a re-establishment, but they are countries today, not countries, they are states today, they are very young states like Slovakia or like Kosovo. And these states not re-establish, but establish their nation state. And it is crucial. We could list a lot of concrete facts which support this incredible importance of the memory politics in interest to re-establish or establish the nation state. And the second one is the reluctance from the critical confrontation with the national past. It is as well very clear how our countries are definitely blocked to confront in a critical way with the own past, because they should have or must have clearness for their society, because they think our position should be homogeneous and clear, because only through this homogeneous unity we are stable and we are capable to maintain our contemporary tasks. And then the next one, well known, the national or nationalist xenophobia against the USA, against the European Union, and as well against refugees. It is so common that I don't need to explain it it more. And then the last one is the widespread vulnerability against conspiracy theories. I mentioned there are only two types of conspiration theories. The one is, because he is a Hungarian origin, George Soros. Many people, not only in Hungary, but in Poland and other countries, think George Soros led the entire world with his big money. And the other is the cultural influence of the so-called gender ideology, which is directed by very exact characterizable crisis circles, that gender ideology should destroy the families, should destroy the traditional values of the countries, like our countries. So it is. Of course, it is conspiracy theories, but these conspiracy theories are very important for these societies to have a clear distinction between them and between us, and to demonstrate the closeness of the society and by the negative, clear negative speaking and speeches against these enemies, the people in the societies feel themselves strong enough, which is needed. So all these facts, today facts and features in our societies, are, according my understanding, legacies of the woundedness. So in sum, wounded collective identity, it is a first conclusion, the collective victimization, and compared with the need for security, autonomy, and sovereignty. So if we will use wounded collective identity for analysis of social transformations, but as well for religious transformations in our societies, then we should keep in mind the core element, the core factors, the core variables are these as collective victimization, the knowledge about, and the need for security, autonomy, and sovereignty. They are the leading values and leading motivations in our countries. And the conclusion, the second conclusion is to clarify that the heteropoietic point of view I started with concentrates on modernization and concerning religion, secularization, but parallel, the autopoietic approach for Central and Eastern Europe should concentrate on woundedness as core marker of the region, of the societal transformation of the region, and securitization as the central connection. To clear a little bit more this shift or this change or this alternative, the leading sociological paradigmata, the social transformation and the religious transformation in the Western European, in the realm of the Western European mindset or societal experiences are modernization and secularization. But if we make a serious regional differentiation, then for Central and Eastern Europe, for the social transformation is woundedness, the core impression or the core experience, and regarding religious transformation is the securitization. Now I am ready then to turn to the question how we interpret religious dimensions of our societies based on the theory of wounded collective identity. So the hermeneutical capacity of wounded collective identity regarding religion is that we have other type of interest, other type of sensibilities concerning the religious dimension of our societies. So the indicators are different. For them, we are interested in the research about religion in our countries. We should investigate other type of indicators to understand the mode of religion in the region of Central and Eastern Europe or region of the wounded collective identity. I will give examples with the next slide. So it is as well very important that we should ask the visions of religious and non-religious people, what is the core element, what is the main motivation, how they understand themselves and the society from their religious or religious point of view. So we should not only ask what is their meaning about the existence of God or how often they spend time for liturgy, but main, if the wounded collective identity is an appropriate approach, then the most important question for religious and non-religious people is how they understand themselves as religious or non-religious people against or in confrontation with this core element or core marker of the society, the tradition of woundedness. And the third capacity is the essential correlation are historical and contemporary as well. The essential correlation is religion and independence, and religion and stabilization or re-stabilization. Of course, I concentrate in this lecture more on the public sphere of more of the public function of religion, but not only. So the main argument is that the autopoietic understanding of the region, wounded collective identity, is the appropriate basis for the interpretation of religion. Because these questions or these dimensions which were mentioned, the types of indicators, the visions and the correlations, it is not included in the theory of secularization. It is not included in the theory of public religion or as well in civil religion, if we should mention Bellach's theory about religion. So therefore, we need an autopoietic point of view and it is the wounded collective identity, and it is the concentration to the securitization as the main need and in front of or in correlation to this securitization is religion to understand. So the function of religion in the process of re-establishing, I have two hypotheses. The first is the religious self-determination depends more on the collective affirmation of national autonomy than on the confessional history and of a particular society. So it is a little bit hard to say, but I think we should say it that in our countries, according to a lot of survey data too, the correlation between national autonomy and nationality and religion is higher than the connection of than the correlation between confession and religious activity, and so it means then that the historical legacy of the nationalism, I take it not a critical way, but as a descriptive term, is higher than the importance of other dimensions of religiosity. So two more concrete examples: the self-declarations of believers and non-believers too are to understand, according to my point, as option for autonomous collective identity. So it means we are more or less actually in Prague, and I enjoy it. So in Prague, in a society, in a Czech society, where the nuns are in a definitive majority, if we reflect how they became nuns, how they become atheist or apatist, as Tomáš Halík used to say, how they become, because the Czech national interest was leading for them. And if the Austrian Hungarian monarchy don't allow to be sovereign for Czech people, and the Czech Catholic hierarchy worked more with the empire and emperor than with the population, as in case of Poland, then Czechs said, okay, enough with Catholicism. Okay, I know that the history of the 20th century for the Czech Republic or for Czechs, it is not so simple, and sorry to speak with so simple, but I want only to make the point really clear how important is the question of autonomous collective identity by the self-religious self-definition. And in Czech Republic is the case as well, and the result is the Czech people are Czech, but not religious. In case of Poland, or in case of Romania too, the case of another, but the logic is the same. For Poland, it was very exact that the Catholic hierarchy was against to any destruction from the outside, and so the people said, okay, our Polishness is supported through the Catholic religion and to the Catholic Church, so we are Polish and we are Catholic, we are still Catholic. So both depend on the dynamics between national sovereignty and church diplomacy. So not only nationalism, but as well the church diplomacy and the church behavior plays a crucial role. But the main argument is that religious self-determination depends more on the collective affirmation of national autonomy than from other types of variables. And the second hypothesis on the same line is concerning the public sphere. Public religion, preference of institutional and financial stability is characteristic for our region, for all religious communities, bigger churches, smaller churches. It is bigger compared with the selection of the charismatic innovations. So if we take Max Weber, charisma and against charisma, bureaucracy or institution, then this very important distinction in Weber's work, then we can observe that in all of our countries, the stabilization of religious institutions plays a definitive bigger role than the supporting of charismatic innovations. So religious building are more important in our societies and the religious dimension of our societies than building religious communities. Or the traditional rituals and traditional teaching are more important in our countries than the creative thinking and the creative performances. And as well, the insistence of traditional structures is more important in our region than the rational reorganization of the systems of pastoral care. So I think then for the religious sphere or dimension of society, if we take serious for as a basic understanding of the entire society and the entire legacy of the society as wounded collective identity, then the question concerning the religious dimension is securitization. Religions should play or play a role to be secure, to live, to think secure in our society. And as well, it is valid if we take people, they declare themselves as non-religious people or at least atheists. So I arrived the last slide, my summary. So it is, I think it is already very clear that we started with heteropoiese, and if we focus on the regional experiences, then the need for an autopoiese is clear. And my answer is, for an autopoetical basic understanding of our religion, my answer or my offer is the idea of wounded collective identity. The heteropoetical view is based on modernization, but if we focus on the social theory, then we can wounded collective identity take on the same level as modernization for Western European societies. And for the religious, if we focus on the religious theory, then for the heteropoietical outside view is secularization, the core element, core hermeneutical view, but for the Central and Eastern European region, securitization is the core element to understand and to interpret religious transformations and the religious dimension of all societies. So by the closing, it is very important to highlight that I am thinking not in oppositions. It is not an opposite heteropoietic and autopoietic view. It is not an opposite modernization and wounded collective identity as well. It is not an opposite to secularization, the securitization. No, it should be combined. But my luck, which I felt 30 years ago and 20 years ago, this luck is a little bit fulfilled, I think, with the idea of wounded collective identity and with the idea of securitization. And now we could start to combine the point of views, the heteropoietic points and the autopoietic points, and then this will lead us for a more appropriate and more fine-tuned understanding what happens on the religious dimensions in our societies. Thank you for your time and for your interest. And so I should close it with Hungarian paprika, because for every hermeneutic, paprika is needed.
Thank you, András. Excellent presentation. Thank you very much. And if you can...
Yes, I try to do it.
Yeah, you can close the presentation and we can see you in full screen and we can start a discussion.
It is now okay?
It's perfect.
Okay. Then I ask you for critical comments, because I should think for what.
Thank you very much. Maybe I'm used to be the moderator and I'm used to the situation that nobody asks. So I ask first and then the other will find the courage to ask too. Okay. So my question, when I heard your fantastic presentation, I had to compare to the situation that I know very well, and this is the situation about Israel, State Israel, because they had many reasons to also feel the wounded collective identity. They are also in instability all the years, actually, and the instability is bigger than ours, because in Israel, actually, the only safe border is the sea. All the other borders are moving all the time, like Syria and Jordan. Every few years, it's changing. And also, they don't know when will arrive another rockets from the south or from Gaza, you know, from different. Hamas, it's not so dangerous, because they put few rockets together from some simple materials and then it's over. But Hezbollah is much more dangerous. They have really sophisticated weapons. And when you had the presentation, I had to all the time to compare, you know. And my question is, if you would use the same structure on the situation in Israel, why we have so different results? So what is the answer in your view, why we are in so different situation? Or even you can think about other nations which are in even bigger danger, like the Tibetan nation, but the results are completely different. Why is it?
Thank you for the question. I am not too much surprised for the comparison with Israel. Frankly speaking, I didn't study properly the history of Israel, the society of Israel, and the religious situation of Israel. It is already a big challenge to know something about the almost 30 countries of Central and Eastern Europe. It is too much. So I have not the capacity to make this comparison. But you are right, and the question is a very good question. And I get these questions many times already, and I am permanently praying for a young student or young colleague from Israel to discuss the possibility and the borders by using of my wounded collective identity theory. But since I don't have this guy, it is not possible for me to think properly about this question. And okay. if the results are different, perhaps yes, perhaps no. The differences concerning religion in our region are so high and so huge and so big, then it is hard to think that in other societies, bigger religious differences could be present. Although we are more or less a Christianity-based region, okay, then we can go to Africa, perhaps, or I don't know, which is the situation totally different.
Okay, perfect. So if you would like to join our discussion, you can raise your hand or just start to speak. And I have another question. Pavel Hošek, please, the floor is yours.
András, thank you very much for your insightful presentation. I really find it very illuminating. And I have to say, it makes much sense to apply this theory on the data. Yet, naturally, I tend to confront what you say with the so-called uniqueness of the Czech situation. I would almost suggest that it seems to apply better on Poland, Slovakia, and Hungary than on the actual situation in the Czech Republic. You did refer to the fact that Czechs felt oppressed by the Austrian Empire and therefore their reluctant or actually even negative attitude towards the Roman Catholic Church was part of their emancipation and national self-affirmation and so on. But there were many leading intellectuals after the First World War who thought then that Czechs would then turn to the Protestant or Hussite religious alternative to sort of support them and provide them with some kind of existential and spiritual and religious and cultural context and framework to shape the newly established national and cultural identity. And it didn't happen. And so many were frustrated and upset and surprised. It didn't happen. Why do you think? Because I tend to think, just one last sentence to add, I think that Czechs actually suffer a lot from not having any strong spiritual, religious foundation. So some of those negative consequences of insecurity and fear and existential or ontological woundedness and being traumatized are actually, I think, stronger in the Czech society because of the fact that it is so little anchored in any sort of spiritually nurturing context or tradition. But why do you think Czechs vote for this expensive freedom and autonomy from anything that would then help them in time of need and somehow strengthen them in time of insecurity and so on?
Thank you for the question. It is, of course, a big risk to discuss about Czechs with Czechs, yes? So
we appreciate your question.
So thank you for the question. Very good question. I have no definitive answer, but I have perhaps two points for a further discussion. The one point is historical. So I think we should be careful with the history of Czech Protestantism and to ask why Czech Protestantism or the Protestantism in Czech have had not the capacity to be a leading factor for the Czech nationalism. The answer is not simple, but the results show that that is the fact, that it was a lack of capacity. Why is Protestantism, why has Protestantism this lack of capacity? Perhaps we can go back for an argument to Emil Durkheim. Emil Durkheim analyzed concerning the suicide. He analyzed to which confession belong the majority of suicides people in French. And although in French the Catholics were in definitive majority 100 years ago, more than 100 years ago, among suicide people, the part of the Protestant population was bigger than the Catholic. And in his book about the suicide, Durkheim explained these data through the argument that Protestant religiosity and spirituality is individual-centered. They don't need a community, and they don't need church to be in a vivid contact with the transcendence. And so the capacity to help by people in turbulent situation has this Protestant spirituality not enough. Catholics are more community oriented or church oriented. We can a little bit too simple to say. So it is the one question. The spirituality of Protestantism have perhaps traditionally have had not the capacity to offer a stable spiritual route for a Czech population. They went far from the Catholic situation. And the other is the question which I don't know enough. It is the organization of the Protestant churches in Czech Republic at that time. I think, as always, churches say, "Oh, we are surprised because of the Zeitgeist." So I think the Protestant church or churches in Czech Republic was as well so surprised, and they have had not the flexible enough structures to be effective in the Czech Republic 100 or more years before. I don't know whether my it is not answer. They are not answers, but they are ideas which I or we should be more careful to take more careful to give an answer to your very, very important question.
Thank you very much. Peter Jonkers raised his hand. So Peter, you can ask.
Okay, thank you, András, for your very insightful presentation. By and large, I agree with you, but there is one thing I would like to discuss with you in more detail. I do not agree with the opposition you make between Western interpretations and the Central Eastern ones. To my mind, and that's, say, relatively easy, recent, the idea of wounded identity is not confined to Central Eastern Europe. I agree with you that it has been determined by different factors, but it also is currently quite dominant, you can say, in many Western societies, in the sense that an important number of the population feel neglected, negated by the so-called cultural elites, and their identity is also wounded. I will explain this more theoretically. One of the expectations, so to say, of the secularization and modernization theory is precisely that cultural identity would not matter anymore at all, that it would be, what would become dominant in all Western societies was a kind of procedural, rational, rational ethics in which cultural identities would be reduced to a kind of folklore. Well, there are, what we see now, and that you can read in all kinds of theoretical studies and even in the media, is that the traditional socio-economic divide in Western societies has been replaced by a social-cultural one. And that refers to, in some way, to what you would call, what you call wounded identity. I think that your interpretation is quite helpful, and to some extent, when you, in your the specific elements you brought up to explain this wounded cultural identity, I completely agree with you that they are specific for Eastern and Central Europe, but the overall thesis of wounded identity is becoming more and more important to interpret Western societies as well. So could you comment on that?
Yes. Thank you very much. It is, you are absolutely right that in the recent publications of not only in Western Europe, but as well in the United States, I would like really mention Brian Turner's works. He focused on this problem, or as well Moisey, the scholar of international relations, the French scholar. He called the entire Western European and Eastern Europe, the entire Europe, he called as the region of fear. So it is right. I think we should make a distinction. It is possible that the feeling today is the same, but the reason and the historical legacy is different. And okay, it is clear that the fear and the feeling of insecurity in many Western European societies is growing. But let me say something very simple. The capital by the families of a definitive majority in Western societies is more or less stable. In Western European societies, culturally, people are capable for long time planning because they don't experience the strong intersections after every 40 years or 30 years. So although today the entire world started to be the same because of Facebook and internet and television and so on. But I think it is, although by the similar contemporary sensibilities, it is not bad or not unuseful to go deeper in the sources. Mm-hmm. And we have common sources, like the problem of refugees, like the problem of the insecurity of the entire internet and mailbox and the entire insecurity concerning the norms of human rights, for example. It is very hard questioned by very influenced groups, or as well the insecurity of the bank system, the insecurity of our economy and of our personal or familial money by the banks. So they are arguments, contemporary facts and transformations and tragedies in our societies in East and West, which make reasonable why we are in a bad feeling. But the legacy is different. The historical legacy is different, and therefore I think we can understand, if we take in mind this legacy too, can we understand the religious transformation in our societies. And I think in case of religious transformation, by all kind of similarities of the fear, the differences are still there concerning the religious situation, I think.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you for the question, Peter. It was very important.
We have only a few minutes left, and we have two questions. One is by David Václavík and then Pavel Barga. Davide, you can ask your question.
Good evening. Hello, András. Thank you very much for your interesting question. I have to say that I agree with Professor Jonkers that I've also a bit problem with reflecting Central and Eastern Europe as a specific case, not only in this lecture, but sometimes I think that it's kind of our post-Soviet frustration to say we are too specific with capital S. Of course, we are specific with small s when we compare the situation in other part of modern European world. But I think that, and Professor Jonkers mentioned this, that a lot of similar consequences, similar problems, which are connected with your concept of wounded collective identity, are typical not only for Western Europe, but also for United States. But I think that it's very similar in some Latin American countries, even in some Asian countries. For this reason, in this context, I have two, I think, maybe important remarks. One, the Central and Eastern Europe, according to me, it's not homogeneous area. And I think that's, of course, there are some similarities in these regions, but still some part of this region is or some parts are more different than others. For example, you mentioned the example of the Czech Republic, and I think that the situation in Czech Republic is more similar to countries like Austria, like Germany, than to situation to other Central and Eastern European countries. You mentioned another specific traits which are, according to you, are typical for Central and Eastern European region. You mentioned the economical situation, et cetera. And again, I think that there are some differences. So that's my regards to reflect this region not as a homogeneous, but also as a heterogeneous. The second is that very often is mentioned that this region is the same region because we have 40 years of Soviet collective Soviet history. Yeah, that's right. It's very important. It's an important part of our modern history. But it's necessary to say that we have almost 30 years of new situation. So, and I think that even in these 30 years, there are some different trajectories of some countries, or the different stories. If you compare the situation in Poland, situation in Czech Republic, Hungary, again, this is the similar but not the same stories. And the last remark, I think that if we want to compare the situation between Central and Eastern Europe and Western Europe, then there is very interesting that before the Second World War, Western Europe was more homogeneous part of Europe than Central and Eastern Europe, from national, from religious point of view. After the Second World War, the situation completely changed because of migration, because of decolonization, and et cetera, et cetera. And the Central and Eastern Europe started to be the most homogeneous part of Europe. It's more homogeneous than Western Europe. For example, you know that the typical situation is situation of the Czech Republic, because before the Second World War, in contemporary region of the Czech Republic, lived more than 3 million Germans, a couple of dozen Jews, and et cetera, et cetera. Now, more than 90% of inhabitants of the Czech Republic are Czechs. It's the same in religion point of view. So I think that it's also to be interesting to incorporate this change into your concept. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Unfortunately, or for you perhaps fortunately, I have no time to answer these very important remarks and questions. Let me say only one clarification, or to clarify only one thing. I don't want it to argue that the Soviet time is the decisive time. In the opposite, I argue to go to long durée, perhaps go back to the Middle Age, perhaps go back to the Holy Roman Empire, and this geographical setting of the entire region has an impact, a historical impact, and has an impact for today too. Thank you, David. Perhaps we will have time soon to discuss these questions more deep. I look to Robert. He wants to close the session, but before you do it, I would like to show you a very recent, from the last week, results of a question, and it is really, really surprising. Okay, only for Hungary, but perhaps it would be very interesting to test my theory according on these questions. These are the betweenness variables. And we ask these variables in Hungary newly through my investigation, and look how incredible huge answers we have to these three questions: that society must remember the tragedies of our past history, Hungarians have suffered unjustly through our history, and Hungarian culture must be protected from foreign influences. I suppose that if we would like able to ask these, at least these three questions in questionnaires, in surveys of our countries, I suppose we would have to get similar huge level, not the same, but similar huge level in, it is absolute sure in the Baltic countries, it is absolute sure in every Balkan countries, and I suppose perhaps in Czech Republic we would have as well very huge yes answers to this question. So although it is not a homogeneous region, by far not, it would be boring, but it is clear that the problems which I try to point out are, I think, valid enough to discuss it and to go further to in the research to verify them.
Yes. András, thank you very much. We have here a very last question. I just wanted to make a remark that the Czech suffered more than Hungary. It's not joking. we should make the list of suffering countries and the statistic who suffered more than who. You know, this is your next research.
Robert for president.
I will make the contest of suffering countries. But Pavel, please.
After this, it is difficult to ask a question. thank you, András, for your thought-provoking lecture. One thing that will stick out from your lecture from me is the case that you made for the need for an autopoietic approach and perspective point of view. And methodologically, it seems to me that especially this emphasis, as well as others from your paper and from your approach that you're advocating, are very much similar to the approach of post-colonial studies.
Yes.
Especially the approach on the need for subaltern voices and telling the history from the perspective of downside of history. So I would be wondering that what can we, as people living in the Central and Eastern European region, what insights can we take from post-colonial studies, from post-colonial theories?
Two short comments. One short comment. In my book, Freedom und Populism, Freiheit und Populismus, published by Springer 2019, I offered an entire chapter to this question, what can we learn from the post-colonial approach? And we can learn a lot. And the other comment is, the post-colonial approach has always, by Homi Baba or by other, always make the point, we have no history as colonizers. In case of Europe, in case of Central and Eastern Europe, we cannot say the same. I am, as a Hungarian, I cannot say Hungary has no heritage as colonial power because of the Austrian-Hungarian monarchy. The Kingdom of Poland and Lithuania cannot say that they have never had something as a colonial power. So it is the situation in Europe and as well in Central and Eastern Europe is very inhomogeneous concerning this approach and not so clear as the approach taken from Africa or from India. But it is absolutely true that my approach has a lot of similar points to the post-colonial approach.
Okay, thank you very much. Our time is over. we would like to thank you, András, for your really very nice lecture that we that just started our conversation, okay? And we hope to continue. Thank you very much to all others who participated today. And please stay with us. We will organize another nice meeting. And we hope that it will be in presence here in Prague or in Budapest or in Holland. Mm-hmm. Thank you very much.
And thank you very much.
See you
bye
soon.
Bye.
Thank you.
Nasredanu. Nasredanu.
Thank you. Thank you. Yeah.